Welcome to the Indo News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. These are the news articles chosen for today's discussion. They are given along with the page number of different editions. Link for the handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping for the discussed articles are given in the description box as well as the comment section for the benefit of the mobile viewers. Now let us start with the first article.
Now let us take up this article. See, this article says that even 5 years after the establishment of Real Estate Act 2016, failures and shortcomings outweigh its benefits. So in this context, let us discuss some of the key provisions of Real Estate Act 2016. The syllabus for reference is displayed on the screen. Interested aspirants can go through it. See, the Indian real estate sector was largely unregulated till 2016. This led to many anomalies resulting in various unfair practices which ultimately affected the home buyers. So in order to bring transparency and accountability to the real estate sector, an act was passed. The name of the act is Real Estate Regulation and Development Act 2016. Its short form is RERA, R-E-R-A. Through this act, we got the country's first real estate regulator. See, RERA marked the beginning of a new era in the Indian real estate sector. It was a step towards reforming the sector, encouraging greater transparency, citizen centricity, accountability, and financial discipline. This act also established the Real Estate Regulatory Authority. In addition to that, this act also established an appellate tribunal. The name of the tribunal is Real Estate Appellate Tribunal. Now let us discuss about the core objective of this act. See, the core objective of this act is to ensure regulation and promotion of real estate sector in an efficient and transparent manner. This act also aims to protect the interest of the home buyers. So these are the core objectives of RERA Act. Now let us discuss the key provisions of RERA. See, according to RERA, the state shall establish the Real Estate Regulatory Authority to exercise the powers conferred on it. In some cases, two or more states or union territories may establish one single authority. In some other cases, a government may establish more than one authority in a single state or union territory. As per the latest data, 31 states and union territories have notified rules under RERA. Also, 30 states and union territories have set up Real Estate Regulatory Authority, and 24 states and union territories have set up Real Estate Appellate Tribunal. So these are the numbers from the latest data. You can use this data as value addition in your answers. Now let us discuss the composition of Real Estate Regulatory Authority. See, according to the Act, the Real Estate Regulatory Authority shall consist of a chairperson and not less than 2 full-time members to be appointed by the respective state. The members of the authority are appointed based on the recommendation of a selection committee. The selection committee will consist of Chief Justice of the High Court or are nominated by the Chief Justice of the High Court. The selection committee will also have the Secretary of the Department dealing with housing and the Law Secretary. So these are the members of selection committee. Based on the recommendation of the selection committee, the chairperson and the members of the authority will be appointed. So these are the points regarding the composition of Real Estate Regulatory Authority. Now let us discuss about the removal of the members. See, the chairperson and members of the Real Estate Authority can be removed only through an order made by the state after an inquiry made by a judge of the High Court. So first the judge of the High Court conducts the inquiry, and based on the inquiry, the state passes the removal order. This is the removal process. Now let us discuss about the grounds for removal. What are the grounds for removal? If they are adjudged as an insolvent, or has been convicted of an offense, or if the person is involved in moral turpitude, or if the person has become physically or mentally incapable. So these are the grounds based on which a person can be removed as a member from the real estate authority. Insolvent, convicted of an offense, moral turpitude, physically or mentally incapable. So far we saw the key provisions of RERA, composition of the real estate authority. We also discussed about the process of removal. Now let us discuss about the important functions of the authority. What are the important functions of Real Estate Regulatory Authority? See, the Real Estate Authority registers and regulates real estate projects and real estate agents. It also publishes and maintains a website. This website acts as a record of all real estate projects for which registration has been given. This website can be viewed by the public. So it increases accountability and transparency. The complete list of functions of authority is displayed on the screen. Interested aspirants can go through it. Now coming back to RERA. See, RERA establishes a tribunal called Real Estate Appellate Tribunal. So if any person is not satisfied with an order made by the authority, he can appeal before this appellate tribunal. So in short, RERA establishes an appellate tribunal as well as a real estate regulatory authority. Finally, let us discuss some pros and cons of the act. What are the pros of the act? See, the pros include timely delivery of apartments to buyers, online availability of accurate details of a project, mandatory clearance and after sales services. These are the important benefits of this act. Now let us discuss some of the cons with the act. What are the main issues with this act? See, many projects are still outside the ambit of the RERA. This act also lacks transparency, and there is also a lot of issues with the RERA website. So these are the main issues with the Real Estate Act 2016. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about Real Estate Act 2016. We also discussed about Real Estate Regulatory Authority. We discussed about Real Estate Appellate Tribunal. And finally, we discussed about the pros and cons with the Real Estate Act 2016. Now, let us move on to the next discussion. Now, look at this article. See, according to this article, IGNCA has been relocated recently. It is expected to be open next month. This is the gist of this article. So, in this context, let us learn about IGNCA from preliminary perspective. First, what is IGNCA? See, IGNCA stands for Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts. It was established in 1987. It was established in memory of our late Prime Minister, Srimati Indira Gandhi. It was established as an autonomous institution under the Ministry of Culture. This is the most important point. The keywords are autonomous, Ministry of Culture. So if UPS is focusing on this topic, they will usually go for these keywords. See, IGNCA is the implementing agency of Project Mausam. Project Mausam works at two levels. One is at macro level, another is at micro level. First, let us discuss about the macro level. See, at the macro level, Project Mausam aims to reconnect and re-establish cultural communication between countries of the Indian Ocean. This reconnection would lead to an enhanced understanding of cultural values and concerns between the countries in the Indian Ocean region. So this is the working of Project Mausam at the macro level. Now let us discuss about Project Mausam at the micro level. At the micro level, the project focuses on understanding national cultures in their regional maritime context. So we can see Project Mausam acts as a soft power tool in our diplomatic policy. And IGNCA is an implementing agency of Project Mausam. Now coming back to IGNCA, let us discuss the aims and objective of this institution. To serve as a major resource center for the arts. To undertake research and publication programs of reference works, glossaries, dictionaries and encyclopedia concerning the arts and humanities. To establish a tribal and folk arts division. To provide a forum for a creative and critical dialogue. To foster dialogue between arts and current ideas in philosophy, science and technology. To evolve models of research programs and art administration. To promote a network with national and international institutions. To conduct research in arts, humanities and culture. So these are the important objectives of IGNCA institution. Please have a rough glance from preliminary perspective. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts. We also discussed about Project Mausam. And we discussed about the aims and objective of IGNCA. Now let's move on to the next discussion. Now our next news discussion is going to be based on this editorial article. See, in recent times, you would have seen IT coming constantly in the news. This is due to the political crisis caused by the assassination of IT president Jovenel Moise. And as per the latest update, a group of 28 foreign mercenaries, including retired Colombian soldiers, were found to be involved in this assassination. This editorial has been written in this backdrop. So in this light, we are going to have a comprehensive discussion about IT on different perspectives. The syllabus covered by this article is highlighted below for your reference. Interested aspirants can go through it. Come, let us move on to this article. See, Haiti is a country in the Caribbean Sea with Port-au-Prince as its capital. Now look at this map for better understanding. In this map, you can see an island. The name of the island is Hispaniola. Haiti lies in the western part of this island. It almost occupies one third of this island. The eastern part of the island is Dominican Republic. From the map, we can see that the island is between the Caribbean Sea in the south and North Atlantic Ocean in the north. So Haiti is bordered by Caribbean Sea in the south and North Atlantic Ocean in the north. It is bordered by Dominican Republic in the east. These are the boundaries of the country. Now let us discuss about history of Haiti in brief. See, the history of Haiti can be traced back to the time when Christopher Columbus landed on this island. He landed on this island in 1492. Later, this country was occupied by the Spanish. It became a Spanish colony. See, when the Spanish occupied this country, they killed most of the natives. After killing the natives, they imported African slaves to work in this colony. So most of the population of Haiti are descendants of this African slaves. After Spain, French took over this colony in 1600s. French used this colony to produce many crops such as coffee, cotton and sugarcane. The French also increased their aggressive domination over this country. So the slaves revolted against the French rule and gained independence from France in January 1804. And this made Haiti the second country in the Americas after the United States to free itself from the colonial rule. See, Americas consist of both North America and South America. So in Americas, United States got the independence first from the England. Next came Haiti. It got independence from the French in 1804. This is the history of Haiti in brief. Now let us learn about its geography. Have a look at this map in order to understand the geography better. As you can see, Haiti is shaped like a horseshoe on its side. It has got two main peninsulas. One is in the north and another is in the south. From the map we can see, between the peninsula there is an island. This island belongs to Haiti. The name of the island is Gonaive Island. Also from the map, we can see that to the northwest of the northern peninsula lies the Windward Passage. See, Windward Passage is a strip of water that separates Haiti from Cuba. It also connects Caribbean Sea with the Atlantic Ocean. So Windward Passage is an important water body surrounding this country. Now coming to the mainland of Haiti, it has got three regions. They are the northern region, which includes the northern peninsula. Next comes the central region. And third comes the southern region, which includes the southern peninsula. So these are the three regions of this country. In addition to this, Haiti also controls several nearby islands. This country also has numerous rivers and streams. It has a lot of mountains. Speaking of the rivers, Artibonite River is the largest drainage system in the country. So make note of it. So far we have discussed about the geography and history of Haiti. Now let us discuss about its climate. See, coming to its climate, Haiti has generally hot and humid tropical climate. It experiences dry seasons from November to January, and from February through May, the weather is very wet. The rainfall in Haiti is unevenly distributed. When we are talking about the rainfall, heavier rainfall occurs in the southern peninsula. Also, rainfall decreases from east to west across the northern peninsula. And these are the important points regarding the rainfall in this country. Now coming to the flora and fauna. See, before talking about the flora and fauna, we should discuss the soil of this country. See, the soils in the mountains are thin and lose fertility quickly when cultivated. Compared to the mountain soil, alluvial soils of the plains are fertile, but they are over-cultivated because of the high population density. So most of the soil in this country has lost its fertility. And now only few cash crops are grown in this country. For example, a mild Arabica coffee is grown as a major cash crop. Next, sugarcane is grown as the second major cash crop. So these are the two main cash crops of this country. See, when we are talking about Haiti, 70% of the island is mountainous. It also experiences tropical climate. So most of the vegetation in this island is mainly scrub, coniferous and leafy mangroves. So most of the vegetation cover in this country is scrub, conifers and leafy mangroves. Also, from the 17th to 19th century, much of the natural vegetation was destroyed through agriculture, grazing and logging. So most of the natural vegetation is destroyed in this country. Some examples of remaining flora found in Haiti includes tall pines, evergreen forest, giant ferns, orchids, cacti and acacias. So these are the natural vegetation remaining in this country. Most of the natural vegetation was destroyed by overgrazing, agriculture and logging. Also, with the retreat of natural vegetation, wildlife has lost its habitat and shelter. See, this country used to have a lot of wild boars, guinea fowls and wild ducks. But because of lack of vegetation, most of these animals are no longer present. Currently, some caimans are found in Southern Peninsula, some flamingos are found in Gonave Island, but most of the natural vegetation were destroyed, and because of this, many animals were destroyed during that process. In addition to all this, the government found in this country also did not take any major step to conserve the flora and fauna. They established few national parks or regional parks, but they didn't take any major steps. And because of this lack of steps, most of the flora and fauna in the country has been destroyed. See, Haiti is known for its corals, but because of lack of conservation measures, most of the corals are damaged in this country. So we can see the flora and fauna of this country are in poor state. So far we have discussed about the flora and fauna. Now let us discuss about the people of Haiti. See, most of the people in Haiti, so they don't have a steady wage. Most of them work in informal sectors like street vending, odd jobs, working abroad, and a lot of them are engaged in illegal activities. This country is experiencing widespread poverty. It is also experiencing a lot of ecological degradation. So this makes this country highly susceptible to climate change impacts. It is also important to note that Haiti is a major transshipment point for illegal drugs between South America and United States. See, as we have already discussed, Haiti lies between the North America and South America, so it occupies a strategic position. So this place acts as a hub for drug transport between North and South America. So this country is plagued with a lot of illegal activities. It has also experienced a lot of political violence throughout its history. Also, one of the main environmental concerns is the rapid deforestation. Due to the rapid deforestation, the forests that once covered the entire country have been reduced to a tiny portion of the total land area. And because of the lack of forest, this country experienced a lot of soil erosion. So almost nearly one third of the land has been eroded beyond recovery. Also, as we have observed in the map, Haiti occupies a position between Caribbean Sea and Atlantic Ocean. So it experiences a lot of cyclones, storms and tropical depressions. In the last few years, Haiti has experienced a lot of floods, landslides, tidal waves, epidemics, loss of cattle and destruction of infrastructure and habitats. So this country is suffering a lot. Now coming to the people's way of life. See, Haiti is densely populated, particularly on the alluvial plains. It is still a rural country with the rural population density still remaining high. Most of the population in this country live in the countryside. When we are talking about the urban life in Haiti, it is limited to the capital and to 5 or 6 large towns in the country. Most of the population in this country live in the countryside. It is still a rural country and the rural population still remains high. So these are the important points regarding the people's way of life. See, when we are talking about the religion, Haiti has got no official religion. The constitution of the country allows for religious freedom. See, the country has no official religion. But however, more than half of the population practices Roman Catholicism. In addition to this religion, they also practice Udu religion. See, Udu is a religion whose gods are derived from Western African religions. So these are the important points regarding the religion of Haiti. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw important facts regarding Haiti. We saw about Haiti location, geography, history, climate, flora, fauna, economy, environmental concerns, and we also discussed about its people. With these details in mind, now let us move on to the next news article. Now let us take up this article. See, according to this article, the National Research Center on Yak has tied up with the National Insurance Company Limited for insuring yaks. Now let us discuss about it. See, in the last few years, the yak population in India has declined drastically. For example, between 2012 and 2019, yak population in India declined by 24.7%. So we lost almost a quarter of our yak population. So insuring our yak population seems to be the right move. It will protect the yak farmers from the losses. See, at present, total yak population in India is about 58,000. This 58,000 includes both wild as well as domesticated yaks. This is the important point. These yaks are found in union territories of Ladakh and Jammu and Kashmir. They are also found in the states of Arunachal Pradesh, Sikkim, Himachal Pradesh, West Bengal and Uttarakhand. Now let us discuss about National Research Center on Yak. See, National Research Center on Yak is a premier research institute. It is exclusively engaged in research and development of yaks in India. It was established in 1989. It was established by Indian Council of Agriculture Research. This is the important point. It was established at Dirang. It is in Arunachal Pradesh. So these are the important points regarding National Research Center on Yak. Now let us discuss about wild yaks. The yaks which are found in wild. See, these animals are large herbivore species. They feed on plants. They are herbivorous. They are usually found in high elevation places like alpine tundra and cold desert of Tibetan plateaus. See, previously, wild population of yaks were found in Bhutan, Nepal, India and China. But currently, the native population of wild yak in Bhutan and Nepal are believed to be extinct. So now they are mainly confined in China and India. So the wild yaks are mostly confined to India and China. They are extinct in Bhutan and Nepal. Now look at this beautiful picture. This is a picture of wild yak. As we can see from the picture, these yaks have a dense woolly fur. This dense woolly fur coat helps the yak to adjust to harsh weather conditions. So they can live even in negative winter temperatures. See, when we are talking about yaks, we have a lot of domestic yaks in the world. But we have fewer than 15,000 wild yaks in the world. So the number of wild yaks in the world are very less compared to the domesticated yaks. Have a look at this map for their range. As we can see from the map, most of the yaks are found extensively on the plateau of Western China. The name of the plateau is Qinghai Tibetan Plateau. This plateau has a lot of mountain ranges and most of the yaks of the world are found in this region. Even in this region, the yaks are usually found in the alpine and subalpine region at an altitude of 2000 to 5000 meters. So these are the important points regarding the yaks. Now let us discuss the important threats faced by them. The first important threat is poaching. They are hunted for their meat and wool. Another major threat is wild yaks are interbred with the domestic yaks. See, the interbreeding of wild yaks with the domestic yaks has weakened the species. So this is a major threat faced by them. Other threats include expansion of agriculture, expansion of aquaculture, livestock farming and ranching, construction of transportation, service corridors, construction of railroads, construction of roads. These are all the major threats faced by the yak population. In addition to that, they also suffer from diseases like helminth infections, foot and mouth diseases. These diseases affect them and they have reduced the population drastically. Now let us come to the most important part of this discussion. Yak's IUCN status. Their status is vulnerable. They come under the vulnerable category. They also come under Appendix 1 of both CMS and CITES. In the context of India, yaks come under the Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act 1972. So these are the important points regarding the conservation status of yaks. They come under the vulnerable category of the IUCN Red List. They come under Appendix 1 of both CMS and CITES. They are under Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act 1972. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw some points regarding wild yaks. We also discussed about National Research Center on Yak in brief. We also discussed about the important threats faced by the yaks. And finally, we discussed about the conservation status of wild yaks. Now let us move on to the next article. Now let us take up this news article. This news article is regarding Jammu and Kashmir Delimitation Commission. So in this context, let us learn about Delimitation Commission. Before discussing about Delimitation Commission, first let us discuss about delimitation. What is delimitation? See, delimitation refers to the process of redrawing of boundaries of an assembly or Lok Sabha constituency. Why is delimitation done? It is done to reflect the demographic changes. See, delimitation is also responsible for reserving a designated number of seats for scheduled caste and scheduled tribes in state assembly or Lok Sabha. So this is why delimitation is done. See, it is important to know that delimitation is a bureaucratic process. According to Article 82 of the Constitution, Parliament enacts a delimitation act after each census. See, we all know that census is carried out every 10 years. So after the census, Parliament enacts a delimitation act, and based on the delimitation act, Union Government constitutes a delimitation commission. This is the official process. So first, a census is conducted. After the census, Parliament enacts a delimitation act. Based on the delimitation act, the Union Government constitutes a delimitation commission. This is the official bureaucratic process. It is based on Article 82 of the Constitution. Now let us discuss about delimitation commission. What is a delimitation commission? See, delimitation commission is a panel set up with a legislative backup. It is based on Delimitation Act. It has legislative backing. See, this commission functions independent of government and political parties. It is an independent commission. Usually, a retired judge of the Supreme Court heads the Delimitation Commission. The Delimitation Commission draws its members from Election Commission of India and state election commissions. This commission examines population data, existing constituencies, and also the number of seats. After analyzing these data, it holds meeting with all the stakeholders. After this meeting, the commission submits its recommendation to the government. Later, the draft report of the Delimitation Commission is published in the Gazette of India. It is also published in the official gazettes of the states concerned. It is also published in at least two vernacular publications. The public can read the draft report from these vernacular publications. Then the public send the feedback, and once the feedback has been received, it is studied, and if needed, changes are made in the final report. The final report is published in the Gazette of India and the state gazettes. And finally, from the notified date, it is implemented. This becomes the basis for all future election until the next delimitation. This is how the Delimitation Commission works. Now let us discuss some additional information regarding Delimitation Commission. See, at the national level, so far, 4 delimitation commissions have been constituted till date. And the last delimitation exercise at the national level was finished in 2008. It was based on 2001 census. Based on this delimitation exercise, the boundaries of Lok Sabha and Assembly constituencies were readjusted. So these are the additional information regarding delimitation commissions. With this, we have come to the end of the discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the delimitation process, and we also discussed about delimitation commission in detail. Now let us move on to the practice prelims question. Practice prelims question. First question. Consider the following statements. First statement. Regulation and promotion of real estate sector. Second statement. Ensure transparency and efficiency in selling real estate. Third statement. Protect the interest of consumers. Fourth statement. Publish a website with records of registered real estate projects and agents for public viewing. Which of the above are functions of real estate regulatory authority? Option A, 1 and 2 only. Option B, 1, 2 and 3 only. Option C, 1 only. Option D, 1, 2, 3 and 4. See, the answer is option D, 1, 2, 3 and 4. All the 4 statements are functions of real estate regulatory authority. It is responsible for regulation and promotion of real estate sector. It ensures transparency and efficiency in selling real estate. It protects the interest of consumers. It also publishes a website with records of registered real estate projects and agents for public viewing. All 4 are the functions of real estate regulatory authority. Answer is D, 1, 2, 3 and 4. Now let us move on to the second question. Consider the following. First statement. According to Article 82 of the Constitution, Parliament enacts a Delimitation Act after a census that is held every 10 years. Second statement. Delimitation Commission draws its member from Election Commission of India and state election commissions. Which of the statements given above are correct? A, 1 only. B, 2 only. C, both 1 and 2. D, neither one nor two. See, delimitation is a bureaucratic process. And according to Article 82 of the Constitution, Parliament enacts a delimitation act after a census that is held every 10 years. Following the delimitation act, the Union Government constitutes a delimitation commission. So the first statement is correct. According to Article 82 of the Constitution, Parliament enacts a delimitation act after a census that is held every 10 years. This statement is correct. Now let us move on to the second statement. See, usually, a retired judge of the Supreme Court heads the Delimitation Commission. It also draws its member from Election Commission of India and State Election Commission. So the second statement is also correct. And since the question wants us to identify the right statements, the correct answer is option C, both 1 and 2. Both the statements are correct. Now let us move on to the third question. It is a large herbivore species currently confined to India and China only. In India, it is found in Arunachal Pradesh, Sikkim, Himachal Pradesh and West Bengal. It is listed as vulnerable in the IUCN Red List. The above paragraph best describes option A, snow leopard, option B, Himalayan thar, option C, wild yak, option D, goral. See, the answer is option C, wild yak. When we take the first option, option A, snow leopard, it is found in 12 countries. It is not only confined to India and China. So this option is wrong. Next option B, Himalayan thar. The IUCN status of Himalayan thar is near threatened. It is not vulnerable. Since the question mentioned vulnerable, this option is also wrong. When we take the fourth option, option D, goral. See, goral are small goat-like mammals. They are found in India, Myanmar, and they are also found in Russia. It is not confined to India and China only. So this option is also wrong. So option A is wrong, option B is wrong, option D is wrong. And from the discussion, we know that option C is correct. Wild yak is the large herbivore species currently confined to India and China. It is found in Arunachal Pradesh, Sikkim, Himachal Pradesh and West Bengal. It is also found in Union Territories of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh. It is listed as vulnerable in the IUCN Red List. It is also found in Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act 1972. It is also in the Appendix 1 of CMS and sites. The answer is C, wild yak. Mains practice questions are displayed here. You can write your answer and post in the comment section below. With this, we have come to the end of the news analysis. If you like the video, click like, comment and subscribe. Thank you.